I want to make sure everybody is here for the missionary seminar next week.
Well, Amber and myself will unfortunately have to take a rain check. We have been invited to a formal sit down with the Lissons.
The Lissons? The gorgeous preaching couple from Texas?
Yep.
What for?
What do you mean, what for? They're a successful, power Christian couple, as are my wife and I. Who knows what the hell we can cook up together?
Well, it's just weird that they invited you and not anybody else.
Thank you.
I mean, there's a lot of successful people in this family. That's all I'm saying.
If the Lissons want to open up a Gold's Gym, I'll tell them to give you a call. I imagine we were invited because they probably realize as Daddy's faculties are waning and it starts getting older and tireder, no offense, Daddy, that Amber and myself are the logical next leaders.
Y'all are not the only married people in this family. Me and BJ are also strongly betrothed and also crushing it.
Not a real family, no kids.
Slam, I like that one.
I don't got time for kids because I'm trying to keep this fresh physique fine. I'm not trying to be all loose and stretched out like Amber's played out pastrami.
Better living through television.
Okay, got the idea.
Oh, back on this shit.
Right?
Yeah, we're here again.
Yes, and I was training hard for the Winter Olympics, but, you know, mixed curling is a tough...
Mixed curling, yes.
Mixed curling is a tough gig. Partly, I found out I got disqualified because I kept shouting, "All right, let's get stoned!" And for some reason, they thought I was talking about something else.
Well, at least you made it back from China.
Right, and... I have to say, I'm sorry I didn't get anything good back in terms of, you know, swag to proliferate the socialism that, you know, our country sorely needs at this point.
Is that what it needs? Okay.
Well, among other things. Plus, it would have just been funny just to see how people at the Republican National Convention in Salt Lake City would have reacted.
Oh, yeah, that was here, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's why I was avoiding Salt Lake for, you know, ever.
Legitimate political discourse.
Yes.
Yes.
Now, and of course, if you're tuning in to TV Tam Podcast for the first time, first of all, this is me, Tommy Milagro.
And this is me, Bill Frost. And we're on episode number 039, what?
Five.
Okay.
395 episodes.
He was trying to show it to me, and I was not paying attention.
It's all right. We don't have a producer here.
Not paying attention to stage directions.
It's okay. Don't worry about it. And the important thing about our podcast, if you're tuning in for the very first time, no medical advice ever.
We got to bring this fucker up.
Yes. Well, we're going to bring it up in a bit here. There will be no... medical advice ever. We're feminist as fuck. And, hey, we're 100% racist free. Unlike some other podcasts. Joe Rogan. Sorry, I had to clear my throat. But we will have some great sponsors like Outlaw Distillery.
Yeah.
This is their newest batch, the New Moon. So what have you think so far?
Liking it so far, yeah. What is it exactly?
Well, and again, from Outlaw Distillery in Midvale, Utah, the New Moon, according to the label, the New Moon is our moonshine that has been aged in one of our used bourbon barrels for no less than 2 years. Mm. This gives it a lighter flavor. It is made from a sweet feed mash. Think of it as a rumsky. Part whiskey and part rum, but does not qualify to be a whiskey or a rum.
Hmm. All right.
So.
Well, it is some smooth sipping.
Yes. Yeah, so.
Definitely.
Once again, thank you to from Kirk and Denise over at Outlaw Distillery. Even there's a different management there. We'll have to have them on one of these days.
All right.
And they got some other new stuff there, which we'll have to try out next week with one of our other sponsors.
Hmm. So. Mixing up sponsors.
Well, it's not the first time. It's not the last time.
Nope.
We're all about blending things in as much as possible. By the way, we're just performance artists, Your Honor.
As far as you know. Yep. Yep.
Let's see. And you've been away for a while. I've been away for a while.
Yeah. But stuff rolls along anyway.
Yeah, all the TV stuff that's happening lately.
All the stuff still rolls along, and let's see. Let me pull up one of these things here.
Oh, some big new shows coming our way to our eye holes.
Excuse me while I whip this out.
Oh, it's only that. Wow, it's only that? Okay. It's not Reacher size, that's for certain. Which, did you see Jack, or sorry, did you see Reacher on Prime Video?
I've seen some of it, yeah. We have a full-size Jack Reacher this time around.
Phrasing?
As opposed to the miniature version of Tom Cruise. See, apparently in the books,
yes,
the character of Jack Reacher is a big dude. Whereas Tom Cruise is not a big dude.
Not even slightly.
So, yeah. So now we got the guy from Titans, and he also played Aquaman on Smallville, I think.
Oh, he did?
I think so. One of the DC TV shows, he played Aquaman.
I know he did Hawk in Titans.
Yes.
And obviously he's moved on to bigger and better things, literally.
Alan Ritchson.
Yeah. Let's see here, but let me, yeah, so let's see, Alan, Ritchson, let's see, he's famous for, oh, holy shit, take a look at this, he's also, done Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles.
What?
I know! Let's see, he's also done Dark Web, Ghost War, oh, here we go, he was in DC's Legends of Tomorrow.
Really? So, what did he do there?
Let's see. And this shit is always cut off. It drives me up the wall here. He was in Supergirl as well as Hank Hall.
Okay.
I think that's Hawk again from Hawk and Dove. So yeah. Not too much.
Okay, I had to pull up a reminder here to remind me what premiered last week because I'm always a week ahead. I'm always thinking a week ahead, like what's coming up. Here's what we would have talked about last week, Murderville on Netflix. Okay. This is a Will Arnett, and it's a half-hour comedy mystery series wherein Will Arnett and a guest star like Ken Jeong or Kumail Nanjiani or Conan O'Brien, mm-hmm. each episode, they have to solve a murder. But the thing is, Will Arnett has the script.
Oh.
The people coming in do not have a script.
Oh.
They have to improvise along and play along.
Okay.
And trying to figure out what the fuck's happening.
So basically better than a murder podcast.
Yeah, I'd say so.
But just marginally, I don't know. Will Arnett is kind of hit and miss sometimes.
He's pretty funny in this.
Okay, yeah. So that's good.
But the big one that premiered last week, in every sense of the word, Pam and Tommy on Hulu.
Yeah.
Which is... the first episode, not a lot of Pam or Tommy, mostly Seth Rogen's character. He plays the contractor who stole the sex tape.
Okay, yeah. And didn't he meet up with Nick Offerman's character?
Yes, Nick Offerman is a porn producer.
Of course he is.
So he's like, you know, you must have some connections. And like everyone says, you got a signed release form. He's like, fuck, we're not touching it. We're not releasing this.
Yeah.
Yeah, but then there's this new thing called the internet.
And that's when things went downhill.
Yeah, so Sebastian Stan as Tommy Lee, pretty fucking good.
Like, is he spot on? Or?
Not spot on. Close enough, though. Plus he's got, you know, the talking dick as voiced by...
I remember hearing about this the other
day. Yeah, the talking dick, Jason Mantzoukas.
That's it.
Yeah. Oh. It's apparently from his book. I guess Tommy Lee wrote a book. And there was a section in there where he was talking to his dick.
Two questions.
CGI dick.
CGI. Is that our title here?
CGI dick. Okay. Yeah. That could be good as any. And but Lily James as Pamela Anderson, you would think it's actually 90s Pamela Anderson.
Wow. She is
so, the makeup, the hair, everything, even the voice.
And the...
Everything.
Okay. The Andersons are prominently.
This deep. Show is loaded up on prosthetic dicks.
Phrasing.
And prosthetic tits. Because Lily James is not quite as top heavy as Pamela Anderson, surgically enhanced 90s version was.
Right.
Yeah, but she sounds, looks fucking exactly like her from the 90s. It's fucking frightening how good she is in this role.
So, okay, now three questions.
Okay, yeah.
First fire away. First one being, on a scale of 1 to Machine Gun Kelly, How does Sebastian Stan's rank up as Tommy
Lee? I'd say Sebastian Stan's Tommy Lee is much better than Machine Gun Kelly's From the Dirt.
Okay.
On Netflix.
All right.
He was pretty good, but Sebastian Stan, yeah, I think he nails it here.
Okay.
Pretty well.
And secondly, how creeperific is Nick Offerman?
You know, the three episodes have dropped so far. He's good. He's got the mullet. He's got everything. It hasn't been much of him, just enough. It's been a hell of a lot of Seth Rogen as his contractor dude.
Okay, and that was the sub question, and you answered that.
Yeah, yeah.
So third question is, since Lily James is the perfect Pamela stand-in.
Pretty much, yeah.
Minus the PETA bullshit. Can we expect her to act in a remake of VIP?
Oh, man.
I'm telling you. I mean, this would just make all the sense in the
VIP
world.
VIP needs a reboot.
Right?
This is right around. This takes place right around the time of Baywatch was still happening. And VIP was around the corner.
And then Barbed Wire
was also right around in here, too. This is late 90s. She was doing a lot of shit.
Yeah.
In addition to getting married to Tommy Lee after on the same weekend she met him.
Good God.
Yeah. But it's definitely worth checking out. It's funny. It's sad. It's all the things.
It all feels.
It gives you the feels, which you didn't expect. You didn't really expect some good subtle comedy, and you didn't expect to feel the feels.
Wow.
I was skeptical as fuck when they first announced this thing. I said there's no way, but yeah, they did it.
Okay.
They made it work.
And isn't it executive produced by Seth Rogen's team?
Yes. Okay. Maybe that's why he's in it so much. I don't know.
That makes sense right there. So. All the Fields, we'll put that as a title here. Working title here.
All the Fields, yeah. Okay. And right now we're smack dab in the midst of the Winter Olympics. Ugh. I have not watched a second of it.
We already talked about my training and my controversy.
Mm-hmm.
My lawyer says that there was nothing pharmaceutical involved. And you at the International Olympic Committee can kindly go off you fuck.
Yes, yes.
That's my statement right there, and that's all I'm going to say on the subject.
And premiering this week, new stuff coming this week, even in the midst of the Winter Olympics, people are daring to drop stuff. Mm. This new one, I'm not really sure what to think of it, but every time South Park premieres a new season, which as it did last week,
yeah,
kind of a week opener, but we'll see how it goes.
All right.
Comedy Central always tries to come up with something to pair it with, another half-hour series to fill up the hour, and they almost always fail. And this one could be another failure. It's basically, it looks like emoji animation.
Oh, dear.
I saw a comment on this that said, this makes the emoji movie look like the Shawshank Redemption.
Wow.
It's called Fairview. It's an animated series, and it's supposed to be topical and political. It takes place in a small redneck town, so... Montana, pretty much.
Of course. It would be Montana.
And since it's animated, you can wait up until the very last minute and throw in the latest shit that's happening.
Look, folks, if you want good redneck animated comedy, I have one word. Squidbillies.
Just leave it alone. The only one you need.
We appreciate you trying, Trey and Matt. I know you're listening to this podcast, but fucking leave it be. We've got a good Squidbillies. Focus on something else.
Yeah, also, that's on Wednesday on Comedy Central. Also premiering on Wednesday, this fourth season of Disenchantment from Matt Groening.
Okay.
You ever watch this?
No.
And it's the guy who did The Simpsons and Futurama, and it's set in, it's sort of a medieval times kind of thing. Abby Jacobson from Broad City is a voice, Billy West, Eric Andre, even Matt Berry is in here.
Matt Berry is in there.
Yeah, yeah.
All right.
Yeah, so that's a fourth season.
That's on Netflix, which I've officially canceled. So
okay, all right.
I'm good right now. All right.
And I don't know if this was deliberate or not, but on Thursday, HBO Max is premiering a pair of Black Mirror-worthy a movie and a series.
Mm.
Black Mirror-esque thing. One is called The Girl Before.
Oh, okay.
Starring Gugu Mbatha-Ra. I'm sure I destroyed that. And this is set in England, and she plays a young woman who's given the opportunity to move into a minimalist, tech-the-fuck-out house designed by an very eccentric architect who has very exacting standards for who moves in.
And is this played by Chiwetel Ejiofor?
No.
No? Oh, okay. I'm thinking of something else for some reason.
So, yeah. But he has a very exacting rules and, you know, you can stay here, but you got to follow these fucking rules. Hmm. And meanwhile, we're going to be monitoring everything you do. I don't know. And also, the girl before the title refers to the previous occupant who disappeared under mysterious circumstances and turns out to look almost exactly like our new character who's moved in.
Yes. And, yeah. And of course, you can almost smell the patriarchy coming off of this script here at this point.
And also premiering the same day on HBO Max, Kimmy, it's a movie, a shut-in tech worker who struggles with agoraphobia, played by Zoe Kravitz in a weird blue wig.
Wow.
Yeah. She thinks she's overheard a murder in the building. Hmm.
Like you do.
Yeah, yeah.
Why does it sound familiar?
Yeah, but this is from Steven Soderbergh, okay? This will give you an idea what we're looking here.
Oh, okay. So it's not played for laughs, and there's no two old guys.
No. It's basically, there's a device called the Kimmy, which is like an Alexa that is monitoring everything. When she tries to report this murder, she's, you know, immediately shut down because whoever committed it is also involved in the tech of the Kimmy.
Hmm.
So basically, she has to get out of the apartment.
Okay.
And go out IRL.
Oh,
in real life.
Did you really just clap like
that,
man?
Yes, I did. Yeah. Yeah. So there's a pair of like creepy tech thrillers here.
Okay.
Both of them look pretty good, too.
And this is on HBO Max.
HBO Max on Thursday, yeah.
Of those two, which do you feel is more watch harder?
I'm going to say The Girl Before, the series.
Wow. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I think I'm going to have to go with that one, too.
As much as I like Zoe Kravitz, I think the series looks better than the movie there.
And we're just saying, Hulu, you know you could bring back High Fidelity for season two.
Maybe, yeah.
I think you need to.
And are you an Ozark watcher?
I am not.
You're not an Ozarker?
No, I'm not an Ozarker.
All right. Julia Garner, who plays one of the villains, well, not really a villain, but a very intimidating character on Ozark, Ruth. She's in this new limited series called Inventing Anna. It's a story of Anna Delvaney, who's like some broke redneck who passed herself off as a New York socialite and bilked people out of millions of dollars.
Again,
based on a true story.
Yeah, sounds so familiar. Isn't there another show that's kind of like this? A southerner that's bilking people out of millions. I mean,
yeah, this is a Shonda Rhimes thing. So,
oh, okay.
So, yeah, you know, it's going to be at least interesting to watch. She's being tracked by a journalist played by Anna Chlumsky.
Of course.
Yeah, yeah.
she needed to do something after. Veep.
Huh? Yeah. So this looks pretty interesting. Also, the second season of Dollface on Hulu.
Okay.
Kat Dennings.
Okay.
And, that's what I know. Kat Dennings, Esther Povitsky, Brenda Song, Shay Mitchell. Basically, Kat Dennings was a woman who was in a long-term relationship with her boyfriend, so she kind of let her female friends fall by the wayside.
Mm-hmm.
He dumps her. All of a sudden, it's like, oh, hey, can we be friends again? They're like, we'll see.
Yeah.
So it's like, you know, rekindling their, it's a...
Kind of a soft pull and hilarity ensues.
Yeah, yeah. It's actually very funny.
Okay.
I would even go so as far as to say cute.
Wow.
I know, right?
And again, on a scale of one to two broke girls, how much better are we talking here?
I have an appreciation for Two Broke Girls just because it was at the one point in time after... Two and a Half Men went off the air.
Mm-hmm.
Two Broke Girls inherited the mantle of filthiest show on broadcast TV.
Okay.
So many pussy jokes. So many. Unbelievable you got it on the air. And it's still in syndication.
Of course it is.
Every day.
And where is our podcast?
Yeah.
Where is our millions?
Yeah, right. So, yeah, Dollface is it's a cool show. I'd recommend it on Hulu. And we got a couple of movies here, too.
Mm.
This one sounds great.
Okay.
I've seen the trailer, I haven't seen the movie yet. This is on Prime Video on Friday. It's called I Want You Back, starring Charlie Day and Jenny Slate, winner already, right there. You got those two. They play a pair of strangers who meet up on the same day they've both been dumped by their respective exes.
I feel a mute cute.
So they decide, it's like, let's team up and ruin their fucking lives.
Okay, I'm already behind this.
Yeah.
I like a good story about revenge.
Yeah, also, I'd recommend that one. I don't think I can recommend this one. It's called Marry Me on Peacock. Jennifer Lopez and Owen Wilson.
Hard pass.
Yeah, that's all I need to say.
Yep.
Yep.
We, as much as I should be supporting my Latina peeps on this one, nope.
Nope.
We're good.
And if you got the Shudder, that app.
Ooh. Yeah, I don't have the Shudder yet.
If you're really into horror movies and cult shit, you should definitely have Shudder.
I know that Jamie Hemmings is a big supporter of Shudder.
Okay. So. Remind us again who Jamie is.
She used to be the book editor for SlamWrestling.net. Don't worry. This is the sports program. You don't have to chug. I didn't mention my MBA.
Right up, yeah. All right. So anyway, Joe Bob Briggs, new double feature.
Yes.
Joe Bob's Heartbreak Trailer Park.
I love the title already.
Yeah, so he's going to be running a couple movies as yet undisclosed because that's the way he does it. Mm-hmm. Right up till the last minute. He won't let you know until the stream's live.
Okay.
What are these romance/horror movies he's going to be double featuring?
What we're saying is if you need something to do on Valentine's Day, this is the place to be.
Sure, yeah, Friday night.
And of because love.
And, of course, Sunday, it's Super Bowl 56. I'm not doing the Roman numerals.
And I know it's LVI, so 56.
Yeah. If I could beseech one American president, I've been doing it for the last several presidencies. I beseech you, abolish the Roman numeral. Use American numbers.
Gosh, it got so chilly all of a sudden. Is this
use American numbers in this goddamn Super Bowl?
Is this a frost warning?
Yeah, you could say that, yeah.
All right.
So, as always, I'm pulling for my Maple Leafs all the way. And the halftime show, I think they finally got the memo on. It's like, hey, let's knock it off with the classic rock has-beens. Dr. Dre, Snoop Dogg, Eminem, Mary J. Blige, and Kendrick Lamar.
Of all of those, I like this. I am very interested how Kendrick Lamar is going to play to that crowd.
Yeah,
I know how controversial he can be. Well, how controversial he can be for white America.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's going to be interesting.
Yeah, so I predict white America will take a bathroom break.
And what's going to happen is the Super Bowl after that, it's going to be BTS. So that's how it...
BTS, okay.
That's how they overcorrect. Tell me I'm wrong, folks.
Yeah, it's going to happen, yeah. So you can watch that on NBC and Peacock. And debuting also on Sunday, I believe it's... I don't know if it's premiering early in the day or like directly after the Super Bowl ends on Peacock. Bel-Air, do you know about this?
I know it's like a remake of The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air.
It's a dramatic reboot of sorts of The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. Will Smith is a producer on this, of course. He's not in it. Mm-hmm. But it's, so it's a, I don't know, maybe this looks more like Power or something.
I'm going to keep my mind open on the subject. I'm not expecting a whole lot.
Says here, Bel-Air takes a fresh and raw approach to this world of swagger, style, and aspiration while exploring young Will's complex journey through a current lens. So the new Will is Jabari Banks.
Jabari Banks. Where do I know him?
Don't know.
All right.
Don't know. But so you have a it's not a dark reboot. It's not Suicide Squad or
yeah. I will say this. After we need to talk about Cosby, I think this is the palate cleanser we kind of need at the moment.
Yeah, I got to get caught up on the Cosby.
Oh shit!
Yeah,
I saw that, and oh yeah, this is pull no punches. W. Kamau Bell. If you're familiar with United Shades of America, you know he's going to have some awkward conversations.
Yep.
And a lot of deep black girl size. So,
and you know what this week was the anniversary of?
I think I know. Is it? Are we talking about the death of El Santo?
No.
Oh, who are we?
But there's also that.
Yeah.
There's 10 years of Netflix originals, which started with Lilyhammer 10 years ago.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I didn't realize it's been that long.
Little Steven Van Zandt, yeah.
You and your Nordic dramas.
Oh, I'm watching another one.
of course you are.
We'll get to it. We'll get to it in a minute.
All right.
But yeah, Little Steven Van Zandt, cool little series. A lot of people think House of Cards and Orange is the New Black were like the original Netflix shows.
That would be my first
thought. But it was actually Lilyhammer. It was there before both of them, yeah.
So they went from mailing out DVDs.
They still do it.
Yeah. And now they are the industry hit maker, essentially.
So every week, you know, for the Jorb, I look at all these things that say, okay, what are the top streaming shows and movies and whatever category?
Mm-hmm.
Without fail, it's always like mostly Netflix.
Yeah.
Like the top five or six is Netflix, and then the bottom four, maybe Disney Plus or something else. It's dominated by Netflix.
And it's going to be for a while now.
Disney Plus is catching up there.
Well, they've actually done some good job with some stuff like Book of Boba Fett and Marvel stuff. And
you know, the new season of Book of Boba Fett is like it's veering into a Garfield minus Garfield territory.
That is the complaint I get from.
I don't think it's a complaint because Boba Fett not that an exciting of a character.
But he was involved in a lot of people's lives when you get down to it.
So. I mean, you know, he was cool as a side player.
Yeah.
But now that he's the star of the show, he's like, really? This is what you got?
It's only been a couple of episodes.
But at least we got some Grogu.
Yes, we did get Grogu. And, well, actually, for everybody that hasn't seen that.
And creepy Luke Skywalker.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Spoiler alerts, everyone.
Mm-hmm.
So many spoiler alerts.
Yeah.
Oh, and we did get Cobb Vanth, so we got the Marshal.
Oh, yeah?
Timothy Olyphant.
Have you ever watched on Disney Plus, have you ever checked out one of these Marvel one-shots? They're like shorts, are about 10 to 12 minutes long.
No.
Then they're pieces of the Marvel Universe.
Mm.
There's one where a pair of characters... fall upon a piece of alien technology.
Okay.
And they start using it to rob banks, and they're finally tracked down by S.H.I.E.L.D.
Is this like leftover episodes from Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.? Or?
No. This is like little short stories within the Marvel Universe.
Interesting.
That are not in any of the movies.
All right. They're just one and done's, and then everything else still moves along regardless.
Yeah, they're pretty cool. Because there's not a lot of originals on Disney Plus. Yet, but the ones they do have are pretty cool, and that's one that you don't really hear a lot about.
Okay,
I'd recommend that one. And the new murder mystery I'm getting caught up on.
Oh yeah, which one?
It's called The Gloaming. Gloaming, G L O A M I N G. It's in Australia.
Okay,
is that in Australia? And you got your typical troubled female detective.
Mm-hmm.
With nearly as troubled male partner detective investigating a string of murders.
Uh-huh.
All the boxes are checking so far.
Uh-huh.
All we're missing is, like, you know, piles of snow.
Well, there won't be any in Australia because...
This is in Tasmania.
Oh, is that where it is?
Yeah.
Right? Okay.
It's in Tasmania.
Yeah.
And, and also it has a melancholy adaptation of a pop song as the intro theme.
Chumbawamba?
No, it's Silent All These Years by Tori Amos. Somehow they made it even more melancholy, which you would think is impossible for a Tori Amos song, but no.
How can you make a melancholy song more melancholy? They found a way,
yeah. And it's really good so far. It's got a little bit of a supernatural undertone to it as well, some voodoo and some dark magics as well.
Right.
Yeah.
See, I would have gone with...
Stars, by the way.
Of course it's on Stars.
Yeah.
I would have thought they would have gone with Melancholy Men at Work. They did it before on Scrubs, so what, were they...
Maybe AC/DC.
What's another...
Rose Tattoo.
Thompson Twins, I want to say, is Australian?
Maybe. I don't know.
That's...
INXS.
Yes, definitely INXS. Is there really a more melancholy version of Suicide Blonde? I mean...
I don't know. Send us your Australian pop and rock acts.
And which song do you feel could be more melancholy? You could reach us at...
There's also the Divinals.
Oh, that's right. The Divinals are Australian.
How about a super sad I touch myself?
That is our title. Super sad I touch myself.
Yeah, we'll see.
I'm liking that already. That's how we come up with the titles for our program. Just like that. We just rattle it off right there. But we need your help to figure out what's a super sad Australian song that could be more melancholy, if possible. Reach out to us via the Twitter at TV Tam Podcast.
Air Supply.
Air Supply is Australian?
I think so. Yeah.
No, I think they're just horribly American.
No, they're definitely not American.
They're definitely yacht rockish. Yeah. We can agree on that.
Yeah.
Reach out to us also on the Facebook. That's TV Tam Podcast. And of course, there's our email, tvtampodcast@gmail.com. If you're going to email us, put us in the subject line, super somber Australian music.
Yeah.
I think that'll do it right there.
So we can get it to the producers of The Gloaming in time for the second season. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, that's when the second season is the best season, except for True Detective, so...
Hey!
Every once in a while, you gotta poke the bear.
But, yeah, this show definitely aspires to be True Detective-esque.
Okay.
It's not in that league of season one, but, they're trying, anyway.
That's the important thing.
Yeah, so, what do you think time it is?
I think it's time to hit the music!
And sports with Tommy Milagro. Go team!
From the sports desk of the TV Tam Podcast, we deliver to you only the sport of professional wrestling. And, of course, we turn right to some important news over the weekend.
Who got fired now?
Not that I'm aware of anybody. I'll check our news feed in a minute here. But, of course, I write for SlamWrestling.net because, thankfully, I got an MBA. And if this is your first time listening,
that, I got a drink.
Yep. And so do you, that listener right there. Nope. And this happened yesterday, on Saturday. The WWE was in Salt Lake City.
Oh, yeah.
As part of WWE Live. And
why weren't you there?
Because I was busy covering some other important wrestling programs, which we'll get to in a minute here.
But this was here.
Yes, but then that means I actually have to be there. So I'm not quite there with WWE just yet. But the results were Kevin Owens beat The Miz. The Riddle defeated Chad Gable. Omos. That's O-M-O-S. Beat Montez Ford of the Street Profits. And Charlotte Flair. Woo! Defeated Naomi. And retained the WWE SmackDown Women's Championship. And I got some nice feed from my niece, who was at WWE Live.
Really?
Ricochet beat Austin Theory. Thank you, Ava. And Becky Lynch defeated Liv Morgan, Doudrop, and Bianca Belair to retain the WWE Raw Women's Championship. And in the main event, Big E, Kofi Kingston, and Seth Rollins defeated Roman Reigns and the Usos. they're definitely trying to ramp up on their way to on the road to WrestleMania. And we're going to go into some other stories that have been coming up here. Now, I mentioned yesterday was the anniversary of the death of El Santo, which you go to News and Rumors at slamwrestling.net. There was a story from 10 years ago that looked on the career of the legend of El Santo. Definitely check it out. Also, in Impact Wrestling, still hard to kill, Lance Storm is now working as a producer for Impact Wrestling. If I could be serious for a moment. And speaking of Impact Wrestling and coming back to Salt Lake City here, Devotion Championship Wrestling will be holding a seminar, a wrestling seminar, with ECW legend and a producer for Impact Wrestling, Tommy Dreamer.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Okay.
So that is a big reason that you want to be following Devotion Championship Wrestling. Are you devoted? And AEW Wrestling had some interesting developments. So the Brian Kendrick, currently a producer and trainer, well, correction, formerly a producer and trainer with WWE, received his release and was supposed to be wrestling on All Elite Wrestling, but they had to back out of it because, funny thing, Brian Kendrick a few years ago was saying some things on Twitter you shouldn't have. So he was kind of QAnon before it was QAnon.
Oh, really?
And okay. Yeah, total conspiracy theory, lizard people, you name it. And as a result...
hey, we're just asking questions here.
This is before he asking questions was his questions. But yeah, they pulled him off the card immediately. And Tony Khan, of course, went to Twitter and said, we are looking into this and are going to investigate this further. So that is still developing as we are watching this.
Cancel culture run amok.
And speaking of the NWA, that's one of the wrestling promotions I write for at slamwrestling.net. Thankfully, I have an MBA.
Glug, glug.
They are getting ready for Power Trip.
Ooh.
That's going to be held February 12th. In Oak Grove, Kentucky. They are filming that for future episodes of NWA Power. Ooh. In association with Tried and True Pro Wrestling. One of the biggest matches that's going to be featured on the card is going to be Anthony Mayweather, formerly Crimson, going up against the current NWA National Champion, Chris Adonis.
Mm.
Definitely a match worth watching, and we'll be getting you all the reports as I write for it at Slam Wrestling. And then the last two things, and I've talked about this before, Major League Wrestling, that I also write for at slamwrestling.net.
Oh, isn't it hard?
It's hard when you have an MBA. Mm-hmm. See? That's how it works, folks. They've been getting involved a lot with HBO, so they are... Court Bauer, the owner of Major League Wrestling, has been involved as a consultant for the Righteous Gemstones.
Yeah!
And oh, and get ready for this. Apparently, he was, he said this out on Twitter. He was also involved in, wait for it, Euphoria.
Huh?
I know.
What?
he didn't say too much in it, but he said, you'll want to watch the next episodes because there's going to be some MLW.
If you can watch through the flurry of cocks,
literally,
there's every episode is like, oh, there's another cock, 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 cock everywhere. Cocks ahoy everywhere.
Is that our title?
I don't see you writing it down.
By the way, he's talking about Euphoria, not Righteous Gemstones. Although
I've not seen full dong on the Righteous Gemstones just yet.
I have. Did
I miss a dong?
First episode of season two.
Tommy Milagro never misses a dong. I'll not hear otherwise.
And this is why I will never be in politics, because of comments like that.
Oh, yeah, we forgot.
And sponsor Tommy Milagro. Go, team.
We just got into dick talk.
Yes, we did. And finally this. This is a terrible segue, but it's perfect here at this point. Keith Lee and Mia Yim got happily married. So they went to Twitter and said, Happy Lee.
So I jumped the gun here.
It's okay, all right.
Sorry.
That's all right.
He's got dicks on the brain.
It could be the genius juice really kicked in there.
In the brain.
Anyway.
Dicks in the brain, got no brain.
They got married, and congratulations to now Mr. and Mrs. Lee, and Mick Foley officiated the wedding.
Okay.
So
cool.
That is a good reason that, yeah, even though it's Valentine's, it's okay to still involve some sports.
And sports, or Tommy Milagro, go team.
For real this time.
For real this time, yeah. So I caught the Royal Rumble replay on the Peacock.
And what were your thoughts?
Lita. Yeah. Nice to see Lita back.
Right?
Yeah.
So now the Women's Royal Rumble versus the Men's Royal Rumble, which would you prefer? And I know the answer. I want to hear it.
I like the Women's Royal Rumble.
Okay. So
was it like 2 years ago now we were at Broovies watching the Royal Rumble?
Exactly.
In person?
Yes. Uh-huh. Now, here's the other thing that's interesting. Shane McMahon was...
I saw him in the men's one, yeah.
Yeah. And he apparently booked the Men's Royal Rumble, and apparently he kind of stepped on a few people's toes, and Vince, according to the reports here, quietly asked him to stay at home. So, yeah.
Okay.
What I don't know if that's indicative of a future endeavoring, although I would love to be the fly on the wall for that McMahon blowout.
Oh, man.
It makes Succession look like it was done in kindergarten. So that's the only sports report I have on that subject. So okay. We are watching the story as it develops. So keep tuned in to our program as we get more breaking news.
Yeah. So, yeah, as far as things you should be watching harder, the aforementioned Righteous Gemstones.
Yes.
And Euphoria. Man, Euphoria is just like, just got renewed for a third season, by the way.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Well, not that there was any doubt, because
Don's Ahoy!
It's the buzz show of the moment. Mm-hmm. It definitely earns it.
Yeah.
And
Zendaya's just delightful.
Sydney Sweeney. I mean, you know, everybody talks about Zendaya,
mm-hmm.
but Sydney Sweeney, who maybe you remember from The White Lotus, show you didn't see.
I know.
She had a much different role in that.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, she's really fucking good in Euphoria.
So
tragic as fuck.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
How tragic are we talking here? Like, what's the most tragic character you could think of to date?
BoJack Horseman.
Yeah, in its own way, it's very tragic in that aspect.
Not quite as tragic as BoJack Horseman.
Okay, well, that's good. So, yeah. No slit wrists there.
Yeah, so, you know, if you have a teenager, maybe don't watch Euphoria.
Maybe?
Maybe don't watch Euphoria. Okay. If you're part of the Parents Television Resource Council, whatever the fuck.
You're still a thing?
That's still a thing. I don't know what, they've been around for like 20, 30 years. I follow them on Twitter every once in a while. They fire up like, we must shut down Euphoria. We must, you know, they're never successful. But they bring it up every couple of years. It's like, here's the new show that we have that is violating the morals of America.
Well, the reason we don't listen to them is because they're stupid.
Well, yeah.
And more importantly, they decided to switch their focus onto books. So now's anyone?
Huh, okay.
I'm thinking that's what they're doing now.
Well, they are literally burning books in certain parts of the country now.
By the way, how are things going in Tennessee, listeners? Call in and tell us.
Burning Harry Potter books.
Yeah.
I think that ship has sailed. It's like it's not like Harry Potter's a new discovery on the horizon here.
Right. And Mouse has profanity.
Then there was that, yeah.
That's Mouse, M-A-U-S, a comic book, folks.
Yep.
Jesus. Anyway, but before we get into the devolution of society.
The dumbening.
The dumbening?
The dimmening.
Back to Euphoria. You're saying, I think we got what's more tragic than Sydney's character?
Cassie.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I did do this over the weekend.
Yeah.
I binged Yellow Jackets.
Oh, yeah.
Holy fuck.
How did you enjoy that?
I get why there's comparisons to Lost,
mm-hmm.
and I think this is the show Lost should have been, but, you know.
Bold words.
Yes, but, you know, the whole cannibalism thing probably wouldn't have got past the first season.
Yeah, so it's a little early to say if it's the new Lost. We're only one season in, but.
But.
Very good fucking season.
I do like how they play forward with the forwards and backwards and what happened.
Oh, yeah.
And the soundtrack of 90s rock.
Yep.
Oh, my God. That was just triggering so many memories gone.
Yeah, the soundtrack to Yellow Jackets and the soundtrack to Pam and Tommy.
Mm.
Also very, of course, very 90s-rific.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay.
You didn't think you'd didn't think you'd be hearing from Save Ferris again, but
I know. I didn't think I would be hearing from like Liz Phair or PJ Harvey, that one was scary. That was accurate. That's melancholy as fuck right there.
Didn't even need to remake it.
No.
But also the soundtrack to Peacemaker.
Okay.
I didn't get to mention this last week, but in one of the recent episodes, Peacemaker John Cena went off on a rant on Hanoi Rocks, a band only I thought me and maybe five people I know knew about.
Right. I was going to ask you about that.
The glam rock straight out of Finland.
Mm-hmm.
They inspired Guns N' Roses.
No shit.
And a whole bunch of, Guns N' Roses stole not necessarily their sound, but the entire look.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay.
Guns N' Roses borrowed a lot from Hanoi Rocks.
Actually.
So much so that Guns N' Roses reissued the import albums like years ago. When Guns N' Roses had some money after the first album, they made their own label and they reissued all of the Hanoi Rocks albums that were previously only available on import in the United States, which I had them all.
Wow.
On vinyl. Yeah.
Because it's got a warmer sound.
Yeah.
Okay.
Back to Mystery City, 11th Street Kids, all of them. Yeah. But John Cena went off on this rant that I swear to God I already made 30 years ago, and no one listened. So maybe they'll listen to John Cena.
Which is a great segue here. This latest episode, John Cena playing piano.
Yeah.
And apparently playing Home Sweet Home. And that's all him.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's the part that blew me away.
And here's the crossover between Peacemaker and Pam and Tommy. Vince Neil killed Hanoi Rocks' drummer in a drunken car accident that you see depicted in the dirt.
Oh, shit.
Yeah. Razzle.
Oh, okay.
Vince Neil killed Razzle.
Accidentally or?
Fuck him. He killed Razzle.
Okay. So just want to clarify.
Didn't do any time.
Of course not.
Got some good rock star lawyers.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but pretty much it was the end of the Hanoi Rocks' big American arrival. They had one album out in America. Then the drummer gets killed. They're fucking done.
I wonder if James Gunn is going to write that in somehow. I would pay money for that.
But the playlist is out there. The James Gunn does the playlist, and you can such deep cuts as the Choir Boys.
Yeah. And Sister.
And that band who does the theme song, Wigwam.
Yeah, Wigwam, yeah.
A week before Peacemaker premiered, they were dropped by their management. Their management said, "You're fucking going nowhere. We're done here." And the band told them, "You might want to wait a week or so because we got this TV series coming out in America." They're like, "No, fuck you. You're gone."
Uh-huh.
And now they're fighting off management and labels.
So basically, they're just beating them off with a stick.
Yep.
And crazy. They're just saying, "Fuck you. This is our money now. So off you fuck."
Yeah.
I love that.
Imagine being the management company that said, "Nah, you're out of here."
maybe they should have just led with, "We're on James Gunn's TV show." That should have been the clincher.
And this is one of those shows you have the skip intro option.
Don't.
I never do.
I refuse to. That's my happy place.
Yeah.
That is truly my happy place. Just to see John Cena and all the cast dancing.
Oh, yeah.
How do you top that shit?
Eagly's hardcore.
Right? That's what I'm saying. He's hugging me, Dad. He's hugging me. Come on, get a photo of this.
Oh, yeah. So you should be, that's one you should, basically a whole lot of HBO stuff. Euphoria, Peacemaker, all of the shows we mentioned on HBO Max earlier.
Righteous Gemstones.
Yeah.
And, I think, and let's see, what's the other one I was binging hard on? Reacher. I honestly, that's good. It's Prime Video.
Prime
but
Video,
still,
yeah. So you weren't watching And Just Like That?
I just refused.
I caught one episode while Mrs. Frost was watching it.
Okay.
And I thought, what's that Applehead doll doing on there? Oh, wait. No, that's Sarah Jessica Parker.
Right.
Oh, wow. What? All right.
isn't Kim Cattrall part of it now? Oh, okay. She's still
not invited to participate.
And that's okay. We're all okay with
that. She's on How I Met Your Father. She's got a job. She's doing fine.
She's got a job?
Yep. Oh. Yes, she does. Yes.
For now.
Yeah. So other things, if you have the Stars, which I would recommend because for the Jorb at cabletv.com, I've been reviewing Stars.
Yeah.
You know, I never really got into using it. It's like, oh, there's a lot of shit. You get a lot of stuff for like $8.99 a month. It's like one of the cheaper so-called premium streamers.
Okay.
It's worth checking out. There's a lot of good shit on there. And one of them being the gloaming. And also heels, of course.
Heels is a good one. I know they're...
Outlander.
Well, if you're into Irish rapiness, so never thought I'd say
if
that.
If you're into that, yeah. it's not all rapey.
Okay, time warping rapiness.
That's more like it. It's like Doctor Who with more rapiness.
Weepy, wobbly, timey, wimey, rapey, wapey.
Yeah.
That whole feminist as fuck thing. Yeah, probably we kind of slipped on that.
Probably lost that badge right about there. Sorry about that.
Sorry, new listeners. We will try to make it up.
Like we have new listeners.
We might.
Not anymore.
Well, in the wake of, the racial slurs of, that other guy, Joe Logan.
Oh, God.
Sorry, I had something stuck in my throat there.
Well, he got his start on news radio. You remember the internet is the new AM radio. So therefore it's just a natural evolution.
So we can expect more Christian podcasts. Ew.
No. That's probably good enough for now.
Yeah, we better stop there.
We can wrap this shit up now, I think.
I will say, if you do want to reach out to us for anything we've said, or if you want to complain to us, we don't care.
We want to hear it.
We want to hear everything you have to say. Everything. So maybe reach out to us either on the Twitter at TV Tam Podcast. Then there is our Facebook, TV Tam Podcast. And of course, you could also reach out to us via the Gmail. That's tvtampodcast@gmail.com.
All right.
Just send anything you want. Or here's another thing you could do. You could stop by one of our fine sponsors like Outlaw Distillery. Tell them TV Tam Podcast sent you for the New Moon, which is now becoming my big favorite.
It's good.
It's our favorite here at TV Tam Podcast here.
Mm-hmm.
Don't need to mix anything, and it's just got the right notes to for some summer drinking here because, winter in Utah. but of course, you should also say TV Tam Podcast sent me to Sugar House Distillery. And you should also say TV Tam Podcast sent you to Ogden's own distillery. So when you stop in Ogden and you want either Five Wives Vodka, Five Husbands Vodka, Madame Paterini Gin, The Underground, Porter's Fire, Porter's Peach, Peanut Butter Whiskey, the cans, let's see, the vodka soda, and what's the other ones that we've yet to drink?
Peach Tea Whiskey.
Peach Tea Whiskey, thank you. And of course, you could also say TV Tam Podcast sent you to Bohemian Brewery. All sorts of great beers they got there. And we're big fans of the Hefeweizen.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Because, summer drinks in Utah.
Of course, yes.
And of course, if you really want to, if you need something good to mix all this with, stop by in downtown Salt Lake. Say hello to Ivy at Boostique. Tell her TV Tam Podcast sent you. And you need something good to mix things up, whether it's glassware, whether it's certain accoutrements, if you will. But no matter where you go, wear a mask. Don't be that dick. Just wear it. No dicks ahoy in any of these places. Is that everything?
That's got to be it. Yeah.
I think so. All right. Well, then we will see you as we slog on to 400 episodes.
We'll get there.
We eventually
one way or another, we'll fucking get there. So good night, America.
And jiggle that handle and, oh yes, you, off you fuck.
Do not talk about my wife's vagina at church lunch. Do you hear me?
It's okay, baby. She's just jealous.
Oh, please.
Because her wedding wasn't even real.
That was cold. Not letting daddy walk you down the aisle?
There was not an aisle, dummy. I don't know how many fucking times I need to say that. It was just like an area by rides. Okay, daddy knows. Disney World was a thing. It was BJ's dream wedding destination. So we did it Nike style, dog. We just did it, okay? That's how we roll. We're seat of our pants. We're fun kids. We're whim babies, so.
We meant no disrespect, Daddy.
Oh, Daddy.
I just want to know who officiated the wedding. Was it Donald or was it Goofy?
Ooh, slice. That was a good one.
It was Prince Eric, for your information.
Oh, thank you.
Prince Eric, who the fuck is that?
The boy from Little Mermaid.
The hottest guy in the entire Disney catalog.
It's Ariel's boyfriend, you fucking bitches.
Oh, God. Oh, Lord. Y'all went down to Disney World, didn't invite any family to come to your wedding, and you didn't even get a legacy character to marry.
What legacy character are we supposed to go for that's better than Prince Eric?
Oh, I don't know. How about Mickey Mouse?
Man, fuck Mickey.
Enough!